Trent Reznor was already 27 years old and experienced with music when he first released Pretty Hate Machine in 1989, his first release under his Nine Inch Nails project. Because of this, he became somewhat of an alternative rock superstar, performing at the first annual Lollapalooza, making several appearances on MTV's 120 Minutes, and even having one of his music videos investigated by the Federal Bureau of Investigation. In 1992, he released Broken, an EP that defied the synth-heavy, danceable sound of Pretty Hate Machine, instead being inspired by an underlying internal aggression he felt at the time. He recorded the EP in a home studio he deemed Le Pig, perhaps intentionally referencing the fact that this home studio was the site of the LaBianca Tate murders committed by the Manson family in 1969. Becoming more infatuated with hard drugs and developing depression and suicidal ideation, Reznor continued to hole up in Le Pig throughout 93, letting friends and fellow musicians visit and collaborate with him. Today, 25 years ago, on March 8, 1994, Trent Reznor unleashed his first maelstrom of aggression and insanity that grew from these sessions, The Downward Spiral, a concept album that was not unlike his personal tale at the time. The story of a man who battles his inner demons with destructive behavior involving drugs, meaningless sex, and violence before culminating in his traumatic suicide. Today, to honor the anniversary of arguably Nine Inch Nails' most important and iconic release, we're going to take a trip down the spiral. Violate you. You let me desecrate you. You let me penetrate you. 1994 was arguably one of the best years for alternative rock as a whole. Several important albums were released that year, such as Sebado's Bake Sale, Liz Phair's Whip Smart, Pavement's Crooked Rain, Crooked Rain, Beck's Mellow Gold, and Nine Inch Nails' The Downward Spiral. I won't repeat what I said at the beginning of the video since you've already got an idea, but The Downward Spiral is the indisputable pinnacle of Nine Inch Nails. A gritty, dirty, metallic, and rustic product of aggression and emotional outbursts, with a bipolar personality and a broken state of mind. In real life, Trent was taking advantage of the rocker lifestyle and indulged in its destructive activities more often than not. This rock and a hard place that he found himself in due to this lifestyle contributed to the tone and lyrics of The Downward Spiral and his follow-up album The Fragile, but that's for another day. Trent Reznor sought to create an album where the protagonist was psychologically damaged, tormented, and controlled by the voices in his head, and in the process wound up creating one of the most beautifully haunting albums of the decade, and perhaps of all time. Because of how special and important this album is to me, I feel obligated to go through this whole album in a track-by-track format, albeit in an abridged format. As much as I'd love to devote several minutes to each track, my recent review of Neutral Milk Hotels in the Aeroplane Over the Sea has taught me that maybe I drag things on too long. So to keep things short, I will give my piece on every song presented here, although some might have more focus than others. Without any further ado, let's begin. The Downward Spiral opens with a sample from George Lucas's THX-1138 of a man being beaten repeatedly. As disturbing as that sounds, it sets the tone of the album perfectly. As the sample loops and seems to pick up speed, Trent thrusts the listener into the mechanical, noisy, and haunting Mr. Self-Destruct. Representing the first of the inner demons of the protagonist of the album, Mr. Self-Destruct is the violent and emotionless side of this person. We see former King Crimson member Adrian Belew playing some hypnotic guitar lines, some of which are mixed on top of each other 5 or 6 times, creating a cramped but interesting atmosphere for the music. At the end of it, the track devolves into a mess of guitar, which might actually be reversed. I've always been under the impression that it is, but I can't say that for sure. Nevertheless, it makes for an intense opening track that sets the tone of the album perfectly. The title of the second track, Piggy, originates from a nickname given to former Nin guitarist and Filter frontman Richard Patrick, who left Nine Inch Nails in 1993. This situation caused a distraught Trent to write Piggy, and contrary to popular rumor, none of the songs on this album that have connections to pigs are related to the front door of the Tate House, which, as I previously mentioned, had the word pig scrawled on it in blood by a member of the Manson family after they murdered the occupants there in 1969. Piggy continues the narrative described in the last song, discussing how the protagonist lost his because of it being the titular Piggy, I am under the impression of at least. This track also brings in one of the album's motifs, the line, "Nothing can stop me now," which is repeated several times in this song and at least a dozen more times throughout the album. This line is supposed to signify the progressive breakdown of the protagonist, both mentally and physically, but we'll get to that last part eventually. Hearsay, track 3, is arguably one of Nine Inch Nails' most controversial yet greatest tracks, with its refrain of, Reznor wrote the song in response to religious groups and other figures that defied his music and moral beliefs. Many social conservatives and parents groups took offense to this song and another on this record, blaming parent company Interscope Records and Reznor himself for peddling music containing such vitriolic and nihilistic lyrics. And while I may be a social conservative as well, I really don't see what the big deal is. I suppose back in 1994, when music like this was not exactly commonplace, this could have been a big deal. Trent has also attributed Hearsay to the AIDS movement, which was at an all-time high for awareness in the 90s. As a result, Hearsay is one of Nin's most secretly political tracks, and I consider that a good thing. Another song from this era that Hearsay recalls for me is Tool's Opiate, which follows a semi-similar thing. Following a religion is kinda stupid, and it only proves your naivete. And while I might disagree with that, in a way, it still makes for an interesting and gritty track, both musically and lyrically. The track also introduces a piano motif that will repeat as the album continues, but we'll get to that a little bit later. Track 4, March of the Pigs. Here's where stuff starts to go insane. Set at 269 beats per minute, the fastest Nine Inch Nails song ever recorded, its entire sound and lyrical setup is visceral, raw, and rough, almost like an audible mosh pit. Trent once again mentions pigs by name here, and the theme of self-destruction, recklessness, and careless violence once again makes a return. Also of note about this track is its music video, featuring a live performance from the band, in a white studio, in which Reznor slams into his bandmates, punches mic stands, and even throws his mic several times. March of the Pigs is one of the many tracks that encompass the loudest and most aggressive sides of Nine Inch Nails, and is also one of their greatest. In my opinion, it's the perfect song to thrash to, whether it's headbanging or sitting in your seat looking like you're convulsing. And here, ladies and germs, we have the pinnacle of Nine Inch Nails' mainstream popularity, with the often misconstrued fifth track, Closer, which is often miscategorized as being a sex anthem, probably due to the song's refrain of, The lyrical content of Closer, as confirmed by Trent Reznor himself, is supposed to represent feelings of self-obsession and the subsequent hatred that comes with it, and projecting it on someone else through meaningless sex, much like I mentioned in the intro to this video. With a thumping, infectious drum beat sampled from Iggy Pop's Nightclubbing, invoking the sounds of a heartbeat, Closer is funky, undeniably sexy, albeit not in a good way, and is one of the most accessible Nine Inch Nails tracks. I've been kind of straying away from the actual elements of the songs rather than just discussing them, but I do want to talk about the outro to Closer. Sweeping industrial guitars layered beneath thick, heavy synths and the familiar heartbeat sounding sample, it devolves into a chaotic finishing synth riff that brings thoughts of Depeche Mode to mind. Before all of it disappears into the same piano motif that was introduced in Hearsay, on a warbled synth piano of some kind, before the final note rings into the next track, Ruiner. Ruiner is one of the tracks that is centered around the demons of the protagonist. In this case, the titular Ruiner is the manifestation, of this character's hatred of God and religious figures, as previously discussed in Hearsay. The instrumentation complements the twisted lyricism nicely, with its sickly mechanical sound forming the base of the track. Trent spits fast lyrics over the instrumental, hitting you in the head and stomach with every passing word. The song's chorus, my god, if I could speak today, invokes that of sexual confusion. I see this lyric as having two meanings. One is the obvious reference to a penis and subsequently erections, and the second is a dominating figure controlling the protagonist, either as a figment of his mind or a person in his life. Adrian Belew returns with this track, laying down a nice Pink Floyd-esque solo in the middle of the song before it returns to the industrial, booming, and terrifying main section. Trent repeats the lines, "Nothing can hurt me, and nothing can stop me now," once again bringing the album's previously established motif to life, which abruptly ends the track. The downward spiral has now truly begun. The Becoming, opening with its film samples of a screaming crowd from the 1989 film Robot Jocks, is the definitive peak of the album's narrative, and everything slowly deteriorates from here on out. Reznor wrote this song not only as part of the album's narrative, but also as a part of his own, as the lyrics of the song discuss the struggles of drug abuse, something he dealt with greatly during the sessions for Broken and the Downward Spiral. He talks about beating his machine, a term used throughout the Nine Inch Nails discography, but most prominently on these two releases. The song, like many others on this record, is chaotic and frenzied in both its lyrics and its sound, with the conclusion of the song and its unrelenting repeating lyric driving this point home greatly. Remember how I said the spiral had begun? That lyric shows the official beginnings of the protagonist's mental breakdown, which will play a major factor in the next seven songs. Crossfading directly from The Becoming, I Do Not Want This is a panic-filled ode to depression, in a different way than the rest of the songs on this record. I stay inside my bed, I have lived so many lives all in my head, don't tell me that you care, there really isn't anything, is there? In my opinion, this is one of the most poignant and greatest lyrics on the entire record, and really shows just how, and not to sound insensitive, Trent's real-life situation was messed up, and killing him slowly inside. Admittedly, this is the track I can only say a small amount about, since it's not too provoking like many of the other songs on this album. Unfortunately, I must also say that it's my least favorite song on here, if I had to pick one. This is as I'm talking about one of my few perfect albums, so of course I'd have that irony thrown in there. Well, remember how I mentioned people got really upset with Hearsay and another song? Well, that other song is our next track, Big Man with a Gun. Opening with a sample of a woman having an orgasm, supposedly, Trent wrote this song to combat the misogynistic gangster rap bullshit that his parent label Interscope was pushing out. He later said, "I listen to a lot of it, and I enjoy it, but I could do without the degree of misogyny and hatred of women and abuse." Big Man with a Gun is one of the most lyrically horrific songs on the entire record, making a metaphor for rape and sexual abuse with gun violence, comparing the big gun in the title to male genitalia, as well as equating the firing of a bullet to that of ejaculation. The track is said to represent the album's protagonist raping and murdering women, so take that as you will. Big Man with a Gun was originally planned to be a song called Just Do It, a quote-unquote fun little song that Reznor wrote about the joys of suicide. The track was never included on any version of the album due to producer Mark Flood Ellis stating that it was in incredibly poor taste. And thus, this song was born, with equally awful taste. However, this one's different because it's making fun of that taste, right? Right? As the album's protagonist makes an unconscious realization of all that he's done over the course of this album, rape and homicide, drug abuse, and generally unpleasant self-destruction, his mental breakdown comes to a peaceful yet still debilitating head on a warm place, an ambient peace that can be equated to a sensation of rebirth. In an album full of misery, hatred, and violent anger, A Warm Place is a comforting middle ground that fuses undertones of internal aggression with that of pure aquatic beauty, and is one of the most emotionally provoking pieces of music that Nine Inch Nails has ever put together, and possibly from any artist ever. When I re-listened to this album in full shortly before doing this review, I was quickly taken aback by this song, realizing that I hadn't felt this emotionally affected by something, musically anyway, since I first discovered Brian Eno's Music for Airports, coincidentally also an ambient work. As the track reaches its unfortunate conclusion, the sound of an eraser makes its way into the soundscape. And with that, we've now come to the 11th track on the album, fittingly titled Eraser. The concept of the track follows the protagonist's wishes to get back to his old self and to reclaim everything he's lost. This part is defined by Reznor's clean vocals until his dark side breaks through again, which in this case is defined by Reznor's screams and distorted vocals, a fitting contrast. This is the beginning of the end of the protagonist's struggle with his inner demons. We'll get to that. No need to spoil something more than I already have. Similar to I Do Not Want This, it's hard for me to find more things to say about this track. Certainly, it's brilliant, especially in the album's context, but it's relatively basic, but not in a bad way. I feel like this would have been better as the 12th track on the album, since it represents the finale of all we've seen so far. But even still, we have one final piece of the haunting puzzle to check out, Reptile. She has the blood of Reptile just underneath the skin. The sound of Reptile is about as accurate as its title. Scaly, dark, and rough. The final moments of clarity for the album's protagonist are spent reminiscing on the person in which he had meaningless sex with in Closer, painting her as a promiscuous woman with a passion for having fun sex with as many men as possible. Fans have also speculated that this track was written as homage to the 1990 classic television series Twin Peaks and its deceased central character, Laura Palmer. Trent Reznor and Nothing Record label mate and former friend of Reznor's, Marilyn Manson, were avid fans of Twin Peaks, reportedly watching it after concerts. Regardless of any fan theories, Reptile features Reznor at some of his best, and is one of my personal favorite Nine Inch Nails songs. Now, with all of these tracks about personal demons, hedonistic life choices, and regretful mistakes behind us, there are only two tracks left on this entire record, partially disassociated from the album as a whole, serving as the utmost conclusion to this already dreary and dark album. Reverberated industrial sounds, complemented by what sounds like buzzing flies on top of a haunting and muted guitar line repeating the motif that we've heard a few times at this point, the downward spiral is the culmination of the protagonist's self-hatred and desire to change. However, realizing that he can't change, as displayed in Eraser, he is left with only one final option. The track leads through an increasingly suspenseful instrumental that eventually culminates in a large explosion of sound and texture. The protagonist has succumbed to his downward spiral and committed suicide by shooting himself in the head. Trent's screams of anguish and repeated cries of are compounded by a whispered and incredibly disturbing verse, which you can read on screen now. For the longest time, this track was impossible for me to listen to. I discovered this album and Nine Inch Nails as a whole shortly after I began my struggle with depression, and everything about the anxious, emotional overtones in the track were too much for me to handle, and sometimes it still is. As the static that closes out the title track fades into fuzzy white noise, an acoustic guitar makes its way into the dusty and seemingly skeletal mix. I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real. Hurt is the final track on the downward spiral, and is the ultimate finish of the album, its concepts, and the characters that it has presented. Although this track and its lyrics are often up to interpretation, I will give my own dissertation on it. I perceive the lyrics of Hurt as being spoken by the protagonist in the afterlife. His suicide attempt was successful, and because he doesn't believe in any god or higher being, his form of an afterlife is nothing, perhaps most expertly defined by the track's barren, fuzzy backing track, with only Reznor's acoustic guitar providing any source of music. He reflects on his past, specifically his drug use, and all of the people in his life that he chewed up and threw away. He realizes that his life was of no worth, an empire of dirt, as Trent puts it. Even still, he's sorry to everyone in his life, and admits that he will let them down and make them hurt. It's almost as if he regrets all of his decisions, including his suicide, even though he feels that it was for the better. At the end of it all, he promises himself that if he were ever given the chance to start again, he sorrowfully accepts that he would start again and find a way. Which after that line, the song leads into a cacophonous explosion of noise, signifying the completion of the downward spiral in that of the protagonist's mind, in the album's concept, and the album itself. 2 minutes of noise follow until the static white noise returns before cutting out completely. Over an hour later, Trent Reznor and crew have assaulted your mind, your ears, and your feelings, providing one of the most visceral and shocking records with a sense of personal reality and relatability, in both good and bad ways. Upon release in 1994, The Downward Spiral was critically acclaimed and reached number 2 on the Billboard charts. It remains one of the defining industrial rock albums, and is credited with bringing the genre to the mainstream. And although the tour that Nine Inch Nails undertook after the album's release was marred with several issues, both personal and related to the tour itself, it earned them worldwide success, and I think it's well deserved. The Downward Spiral is undoubtedly Trent Reznor's magnum opus, as both a reflection of his inner process and a character that he made up in his head. Although he was already struggling with drug abuse and depression during the album's production cycle, the album's success resulted in these problems worsening, with Reznor entering rehab and almost committing suicide on several occasions. These experiences will be documented in what can be considered the spiritual successor to this album, The Fragile. Also a fantastic album, but it doesn't come close to this masterpiece. As emotionally draining as it can be sometimes, The Downward Spiral remains one of my favorite albums of all time, and I recommend it to any fan of alternative rock or anyone looking to check out important albums of the 90s, and perhaps of all time. The Downward Spiral has the distinction as being one of my indispensable essential albums, currently ranked at number 4 on my top albums of all time. With that, I give Nine Inch Nails' The Downward Spiral a 10 out of 10. Hey everybody, Gabe here. Thanks so much for watching, as always, I greatly appreciate it. I'm incredibly sorry that this video is a bit delayed, as the album's anniversary is March 8th, and the intro says that the date is March 8th, so again, I'm very sorry. Since I created this channel a year ago, The Downward Spiral has been an album I've always wanted to cover, and I found it fitting to cover it for its 25th anniversary. I hope you all enjoyed this review, as it continued my experimental style of editing and even my writing. I wanted to give this album a worthy video, and I feel like I succeeded. I'll have some more videos out periodically over the next few months, so please keep an eye out for those. Once again, thanks all for watching. Please feel free to like, comment, subscribe, but of course, only do it if you wish. And I'll catch you all in the next review. Take care, everyone.